Good morning. I want to welcome you here this morning, and we have the privilege this morning to worship the Lord, to come into His presence in a unique way, and to be together as a church family, and to tell Him how awesome He is, and to sing to Him, and to hear from His Word. And so let's just begin this morning to hear His call to worship. He invites us to worship this morning from Psalm 34. Let's stand and recite this together. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt His name together. I sought the Lord, and He answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Father, we are truly overwhelmed by Your great faithfulness to us. Lord, You are faithful. You're unchanging. You're unchangeable. Lord, days and nights, summer, winter, springtime, harvest, they all remind us that as you are, you always will be. Lord, you've pardoned our sin. You've given us a peace that will last forever. You've united us to yourself, and you've promised us that you will never leave us or forsake us. You've given us strength for today, for what you've called us to do, and you've given us an eternal hope. Father, there's numberless blessings. There are these, and then there are 10,000 beside these, and we just want to unite our hearts and tell you we love you, you are awesome, and we're grateful to be called your children. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's pray together this prayer of adoration that I forgot. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, Almighty and everlasting God, you have brought us safely to the beginning of this day. Defend us by your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin nor run into any danger, and that guided by your Spirit, we may do what is righteous in your sight through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Our New Testament reading this morning comes from Ephesians chapter 4. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we're members of one another. Be angry and don't sin. Don't let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Let's stand up and sing together.
Let
Please be seated. As we come to a time now where we confess our sins to the Lord, we need to remember that we're coming to a God who is rich in love and slow to anger. His name is great and his heart is kind. And he's made a way for us to come into his presence with singing and joy and rejoicing and confess our sins to him. The Apostle Paul reminds us in Romans 8, I'm sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. They haven't, they won't, and they can't. If you're able to kneel, I would encourage you to do that. If not, you can just kneel in your hearts. We'll have an opportunity to confess our sins corporately, responsibly, and then you'll have a time to confess your sins individually before the Lord. Remember your mercy, O Lord, and your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Remember not the sins of our youth or our transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember us, for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy on us. Turn to us and be gracious to us, for we are lonely and afflicted. The troubles of our hearts are enlarged. Bring us out of our distresses. Consider our affliction and my troubles, and forgive all our sins. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy on us. Father, we thank you that in your word you've told us that we have confessed our sins to you and that you are faithful and you're just to forgive us of our sins and that you have cleansed us from all of our unrighteousness. For Christ's sake, amen. Please stand and just receive the Lord's assurance of your pardon. The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. Please be seated. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you are rich in love and slow to anger. Lord, your name is great and your heart is kind and you're faithful. And not one of your promises has ever been broken, nor will it ever be for all eternity. And Lord, we could find 10,000 more reasons to say thank you and to praise you. And we know that we will be grateful for all eternity for who you are and what you've done for us. And we ask you, Lord, that you would help us to understand the depth of your love for us, that we would live in light of that, that we would live in light of the fact that your smile is on us and that your steadfast love never changes and your mercies never come to an end. Father, we thank you that you hear our prayers. Lord, you tell us to pray, to cast our anxieties upon you because you care for us. And so, Lord, we would pray. We pray for those that are in authority over us in our country and in our state. Father, we pray for President Biden. We pray for the U.S. Congress and Supreme Court. We pray especially that you would give them wisdom and insights. And Lord, give them a desire to know what you would have them to do and to do it. Father, we pray for our local officials, for Governor Lee. We pray for Mayors Cooper and Anderson. We pray that you'd be with them and that you would give them good counsel. And Lord, that you would bless us through them. Father, we thank you for the privilege you give us to be involved in your work here in our city. Lord, we thank you for our relationship with Strong Tower Community Partnership, and we pray that you would just continue to bless that, and thank you for the opportunity to be involved in the Bless Fest yesterday, and we pray, Lord, that you would just help us to find more opportunities to be a blessing as we've been blessed. Lord, we pray for our sister churches, especially this morning for Redeemer Presbyterian and Dixon. We pray that you bless them. And Father, we thank you for our missions committee, and we pray that you would just be with them. Lord, you told us in your word to go into all the world and make disciples of all the nations. And we pray that as these men and women see how we would be a part of that in our church, we pray that you'd give them wisdom. Lord, that you would provide opportunities for us to be more involved in that. Lord, you told us to pray that you, the Lord of the harvest, would thrust forth laborers into your harvest field, and we pray that you'd do that. Lord, the fields are white unto harvest, and we pray that we would be involved in that harvest. Father, we want to thank you for what you've done in our midst. We want to thank you for the new marriage, for Ann Grace and Alex, and we just pray for them, their life together, that you would bless them and unite their hearts, and we ask them that you would bless them and their life together. Father, we thank you for the successful surgery with Stuart Tudor, and we pray that you would just continue to give her strength and healing, that you would just continue to heal her heart, Lord, both physically and spiritually. And we thank you for that. Father, we pray for those who are sick among us. We especially would think of Julie Martin and Susie Julian and Sue and Tex Rudnicki and Cheryl Darnell. We pray that you'd be with them and that you would bring healing with them and bless those who care for them and give them strength and energy to do that. Father, we ask you that you would be with those who are grieving. We especially think of Joseph Shields and his family as they grieve the death of his father. We pray that you would be with them. And Lord, for Jeremy Kaith and his family as they grieve the death of his grandfather. And we just pray that you would just be with them, let them know your presence, that you are near to them, and that you love them. Father, we thank you that we get to hear your word this morning. We pray you'd give us open hearts and open minds and that our hearts would be fertile soil and that your word would take root and grow and you would bear fruit through your word in our hearts. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we want to thank you again for being here with us and welcome you. If you can, there's at the end of each of the aisles, hopefully, there's a black pad. And if you would take it out and let us know you're here. And if you're a visitor with us, we'd love to get your contact information so we can get you some stuff. And if you're, and pass it back down the aisle. And if you see somebody on your aisle, maybe you don't recognize their name, at the end of the service, we would encourage you to meet them. Tell them you're glad they're here and welcome them. Just a couple of announcements. For about the next two Sundays, next Sunday, there's going to be a congregational meeting at 9:45, which is a Sunday school time, and it's going to be in here. And the purpose of that meeting is to elect officers both for our corporation and for our church. We're going to have an election of elders and deacons, and you're going to get an email about that with some biographical information about them and pictures, and that it appears to me a lot of them have been photoshopped, but they're pictures of all the guys, and just take a look at those and be in prayer for that election. Communicant members of our church can vote. If you have a child that's in kindergarten through fifth grade, there'll be an opportunity for them to be in the fellowship hall for care. And also, next Sunday, we will recite together Psalm 121. Now, there are two different kinds of people in the world. There are kinds that prepare right along for something like this, and there are those that will be up Saturday night memorizing Psalm 121. You can today be kind of a hybrid and start right now for next week. And so just kind of remember that and kind of prepared. I think we'll recite it all together, and so there is kind of security in numbers, but we would encourage you to do that, and we'll do that next week, and as we've done this together. Then on August 13th, we're going to return to child care and children's Sunday school. There's going to be a new check-in procedure. There's going to be an email that comes out to you parents with details of that, and so we would encourage you to take a look at that. And then that's August 13th will be the start of our new semester. And then at 5 o'clock that Sunday night, the 13th, there's going to be a dinner out and a picnic, and you don't have to, it's no charge, just come and have fun. So we would encourage you to come, get to know some people you don't know as we start our new semester. And so now there's a time in our worship service where we honor the Lord with our gifts for Him and the privilege we have to be involved in His work. The Apostle Paul tells us that as a man purposes in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or out of necessity, because God loves a cheerful giver. Because God is a cheerful giver. So let's offer to Him.
From the depths of woe I raise to Thee the voice of lamentation. Lord, turn a gracious ear to me and hear my supplication. If Thou iniquities dost mark, our secret sins and misdeeds dark, oh, who shall stand?
Yeah. Well, another good morning to you. My name is Ryan. I'm one of the pastors on staff here, and delighted to have you again with us. I want to invite you to turn your bulletin to Psalm 130. You can find it in a pew Bible as well. We're going to be continuing our series in the Songs of Ascents. We have said that these psalms really do represent a body of songs that worshipers would have sang as they were on their way up to temple worship in the city of Jerusalem, as they made their way there. These songs were on their lips. And we're going to take a look today at Psalm 130, which is a very famous psalm throughout church history. This was St. Augustine's favorite psalm. This was John Calvin's favorite psalm. It was John Owen's favorite psalm. So if any of these names ring a bell to you, we're really dealing with some great gems today. And so we're going to take a look here at this. And kids, you can find something in the sermon like this. I would love for you to think about what a watchman is and why the psalm gives us an image of a watchman, of what faithfulness looks like. So I invite you to stand this morning, if you'll follow along as I read from Psalm 130, this song of ascent. Hear now the reading of God's word. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his hope, word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen for the morning, more than watchmen for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you please be seated? Will you pray with me? So we ask the Lord to bless our time now. Father, we ask that you would come by your Spirit and that you would show us Jesus. We know that apart from you, we can do nothing, and that means hearing what you have for us this morning. And so we, your servants, come with open hands and open hearts, and we ask that you would meet us. Lord, speak to us, we pray. And it's through Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, I was surprised at what wasn't being said. That was what was running through my head when I'd purchased a new family computer several years ago. See, when I pushed the power button, nothing happened except the button went in just a little bit. And so knowing that this machine was just moments out of the box, I picked up the phone, I called Apple Care, and that was where the real fun began. We tried troubleshooting. There were tons of these little contingency statements from the other end of the phone. Well, if this were working so, it should be just fine. Well, I know all that. That's why I'm calling you. But these, I felt, were standard company lines that signaled a sure problem in performance, but in no way signaled a problem in design. The story ended well, by the way. I was given a new computer that we continue to use to this day. But what stood out to me that day was what wasn't said. And it was something like this. Mr. Anderson, we're sorry. We sent you a bad machine that doesn't work. And the amount of energy spent on the phone that day to avoid that statement of fact was marvelous, really. And as I hung up the phone, I immediately thought, I get that guy on the other end of the phone. For there are times in my life where I will dance circles around the fact, admitting that I have done something wrong. Now, I know that y'all can't possibly relate to what I'm talking about. But aren't there moments, truly, in all of our lives where we'll do a whole word gymnastics routine, denying the fact that we've blown it, that we've screwed up somehow, that we've caused some problem, that we've damaged some relationship, that we've sinned against God, etc., etc., rather than doing the simple thing of just what? Owning it. I'd like to be that sort of person more and more. Maybe you would be too. I bet your spouse and your kids wish that you were as well. But how do we do that? Because the problem is we won't. Or better, we can't. That is, unless we see the gift that Psalm 130 is giving us. Let me explain. The psalm is a song that sings of the thick as the universe forgiveness that God gives to us in our guilt. And it is one that meets real blue check certified sinners that we really are. And the liberation from the denial about ourselves comes. It comes when we see first that there is surprisingly something stronger than our denial to hold us. Something more substantial than self-justification to give us a basis for our lives. And something more identity-forming than being true to myself. And what is it? Psalm 130 tells us it's the mercy of God. It's the mercy of God. And when this song comes home in your life, you are not only able to be associated with a busted computer, you're able to own a busted life. For if God has shown us mercy, then we're free. We're free to live for Him. Not just a life marked with more honesty and less denial, but one that delights in Him. Not to earn His love, but because we already have it. This is a song to Him where mercy is our music, where hope is our lyric, and where redemption is the score. And so friends, brothers and sisters, this morning, I want us to hop right in with a series of observations about Psalm 130, where we begin to see the discovery of forgiveness. This was actually John Owen's phrase throughout his book, the discovery of forgiveness. And first, let's look at these first three verses where it shows us our, very, very plainly, our need for forgiveness. The unnamed psalmist writes there in verses 1 and 2, he says this, he says, "Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy." So what were these debts from verse 1 that he's speaking of? And what are these pleas of mercy that arise from them? Three times in the psalm, twice in Psalm 69 and once here, debts is an aquatic image. And it's one of drowning. It's one of being submersed in all sorts of problems, in chaos, and in disarray. And these pleas for cries, or these cries for mercy, these pleas for mercy, it again shows up in the Psalter about seven times, and all of them refer to some circumstance that is bigger than the singer. But something that's overwhelming them, and they're these cries for help out of that. So you might see them when there's a cry for mercy against enemies, or when things are not going well in the singer's life. They'll often use the language of pleas for mercy, but together they speak of a situation that is too big for us, where with a little bit of trying harder by pulling up our own bootstraps is of no help whatsoever. Listen to what Derek Kidner, the Old Testament commentator, writes. He writes about these verses, "Self-help is no answer to the depths of distress, however useful it may be in the shallows of self-pity." And while we might wish that these depths were hard external circumstances that are solely in view, the psalm, however, peels back the onion a little bit and shows us more. Look at verse 3 there. He says, "O Lord, if you, O Lord, should mark iniquities." And there it is. He zooms right in that these pleas are of a special kind. They are about his guilt, for that is what iniquities bring. Iniquities, you see, aren't mishaps. They're not character flaws. They are breaks in God's law and the consequences of doing so. And so if God were to mark them, if he were to keep them, in other words, keep record of them, you know what the outcome would be? Not one of us, including the man in the robe, not one of us would stand. That's what the psalmist is seeking. So he's saying this, in the end, the first part of the psalm leaves us seeing the desperate state that he is in, the great need he has because of it, and get this, his utter inability to do anything to fix it. The discovery of forgiveness always begins in the depths, not only for the songwriter, but for people like you and me. And I must say, just by way of implication, that is a hard place. It's a very hard place. It's far easier to be, of course, than it is to get there, because it requires an honesty and an integrity that so many of us just don't have. You do know to be a Christian means to look at your sin against God, to name it as such. It is to see how it is burying you, and then to come to the conclusion that there is nothing that you can do about it. No self-help strategies, no Instagram entertainments, no stock portfolio can fix it. No, but by grace, the singer says, he is crying out in his desperate need to the only one who can do anything about the situation. You see it, it is to the Lord himself, verse 2 shows us, that he's pleading with God to hear him in his cries, and to do something about his iniquity and his guilt. Now, listen, by way of application, this will probably grate against every sensibility inside of you. Why? First, because as Paul Tripp, the author and writer, loves to speak about, is that each of us have an internal lawyer that's always on. Do you know what I'm talking about? That internal lawyer that never takes a vacation and works for free. What do I mean by that? There's always someone that's willing to rise to your defense and to plead your innocence in face of your guilt. And here are some of the leading arguments that your inner lawyer uses. It wasn't really my fault. That's a great strategy. It's a common line of defense. Secondly, it was, you know, it's things aren't that bad. Just look around. They're not that bad. And the third line of defense that you can possibly find in your own heart is, come on, who are you kidding, Ryan? You make the rules anyway, so what difference does it make? All of these strategies are deep beneath the surface to try to get you to mask and to try to get you to see that you are not as innocent, that you're more innocent than you actually are. Easy for me to say. Here's what I think is really impressive. Why is this embedded in the Bible? For church-going people. For folks who are concerned with righteous living. You know why? Because this is a particular strategy that we're all so adept at. And we need mercy for it. Secondly, let me show you a second reason. In the last 75 years or so, we have been told by the narratives of the broader culture that we need to do away with the notions of sin and guilt altogether, effectively reducing our need for forgiveness to an infinitesimal amount. After all, if moral absolutes are what you make them to be, in other words, everybody needs to determine for himself or herself what is right or wrong, then you just need to do away with the standard that's causing you such unrest. But let me tell you something. There's a lot of babies in that discarded bathwater. And good luck calling anything evil or not justifying everything with that empty bin. In fact, good luck emptying it. The modern culture at this point offers a cure that is far worse than the disease. But the Bible, Psalm 130, instead gives us a better way by honestly look at verses 1 and 2, by honestly crying out to a gracious God about the ways that we have blown it. What hope do we have then? What hope do we have for the condition that Psalm 130 and these first few verses speaks of? Well, let's go to verse 4. Where John Owen, who wrote about this, spent 227 pages. He's going to scratch the surface on what I'm going to give you today, okay? I'm just kidding. Let's take a look at verse 4, where we see not only the need for forgiveness, but the gift of forgiveness. There's a big contrast, a big swing, a big concessive, if you're a grammarian with that word but. But with you, that is with God, there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. Forgiveness. That's God's free offer of pardon to sinners. And this Hebrew word here, as folks like to point out, is never used of man forgiving man. It's a God-only verb. That's a God-only verb. And it has the idea of letting go of something or sending away as to not be held liable or not to enforce the penalty of a conviction. Two quick illustrations to perhaps drive this in. Every week you likely, unless you forget like I do, you will roll your garbage can out. For us, it's Tuesday mornings. And when I get home at 5 or 6 o'clock, if I open that bin, it's gone. The garbage is gone. It's taken away to somewhere. I don't even know where it's going. And that's when our sin is, that's what the image of forgiveness is. And now a more biblical example. The Old Testament image, you might have heard of it, of a scapegoat. One day a year, on the Day of Atonement, Leviticus 16 tells us, the high priest would offer a ram and a goat for sacrifices for both himself and for the people. But there was a third animal, and it wasn't killed. Instead, I want you to listen to how Leviticus 16 tells us about what's going on with that goat. And Aaron shall lay both of his hands on the head of the live goat. And he shall confess over it all the iniquities, same word, of the people of Israel, and all their transgressions and all their sins. And he shall put them on the head of the goat and send it away into the wilderness by the hand of the man who is ready. The goat shall bear all the iniquities on itself to a remote area, and he shall let the goat go free in the wilderness. In other words, do you catch that? The things that, if marked, would allow no one to stand are taken away by an escape goat or by a scapegoat. Aaron would lay his hands, confess the sins of his people, and then pop the bottom of that thing, and it would run off into the wilderness, and you would never see it again. And what was the picture you were supposed to walk away with? That's my sin. It's gone forever. I'm never going to see them again. And that's exactly what the image is here. And here's what I want you to see. As a result, all of the lies that the flesh, the world, and the devil tell you, I want you to know that if you walk out of here with nothing else today, that God delights in forgiving sinners. That God, he takes pleasure in taking your sin away from you. Listen to how God speaks about his own name in Exodus chapter 34. He says, the Lord, speaking about himself, passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving, guess what? Iniquity and transgression and sin. And this is what he reveals to us, isn't it? In Jesus, that greater scapegoat, the one upon whom all of our sins were placed and who was carried along with them out of sight, out of your sight, and so to speak, out of God's sight even, where he remembers them no more. And God, through Jesus, speaks peace to you. Nothing else remains but peace between you and him to keep you at a distance. And so therefore, if you're a Christian, it is senseless for you to carry around your guilt any longer. It's foolish. Why do you want to hold on to something that Jesus has borne off into never, never land? That's the promise of the gospel, dear friends. This is what Jesus does for us. You don't own that anymore. You gave it to Jesus. And if you trusted in him, it's time for you to treat it where it is, somewhere off in the wilderness. But if it means today, this also means if you're not a Christian today, there's no way in a room this size that everybody in here believes in Jesus. But if you're not a Christian today, I have got fantastic news for you. Because that rap sheet of yours that really is too big for you to carry, too long to speak of, But down in the depths, it's got you down in the depths. Today, it can be done away with. Why? Because with you, there is forgiveness. There is forgiveness in Christ. Forgiveness cannot be earned. It's not called for earnedness. It's called forgiveness. It's received as a gift. And in Jesus is a new record. Christ's very own can be given to you, but it cannot be bought. It cannot be bought even with your best works. You see, they're part of the problem. Forgiveness comes as a handout. It's literally charity. That's where we get our word. It's grace. Every Christian has received a handout in grace. So there's one more thing I want to say. We say, well, if I receive this gift, will I have to change my life? And the answer is yes and no. Your life will be changed, but it will primarily be God Himself leading you in the change that in due time is be wrought out by the Holy Spirit. That is how the Christian life works. Do you know that today? Would you please come to Jesus? Would you please cast your life upon Him? He is worth 1,000 charms. He is wonderful, and He is beautiful, and He forgives sin. Lastly, I want to show you that the psalmist doesn't stop there with the gift of forgiveness or the need of it, but he shows us, third, a life lived out of forgiveness, or a life of forgiveness. And I'm looking here, lastly, at these verses 5 and following. First of all, I want you to notice the what of the life of forgiveness. When in the depths, the singer waits for something, or better, a someone. Turn your eyes there. Verse 5. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in His word, I hope. Verse 6. My soul waits for the Lord. It's the Lord Himself. And this as the one with the expectancy of a watchman looking for the dawn to arrive. Now, watchmen, if you are unfamiliar, were those stationed within a city, or particularly on a city wall. And they were inside the city, and they looked out for threats in the middle of the night, and they looked for the coming dawn as well. They were the security systems of a city. And when dawn arrived, the threats were severely lessened. So, you'll notice it is not in better circumstances that he is looking for. I look for better circumstances, and that will be my hope. No, and I can tell you there has been more consternation in my very life by looking to things outside of the Lord for my hope. How about you? We could probably write books about it. The psalmist is reminding us once again to look for Jesus, to look to the Lord. Secondly, the way to do that, it is in waiting and hope, he says. Notice there, what do watchmen do? They know morning is coming. Has there ever been a time when it didn't come? The watchman knew that. And more than watchmen for the morning, the singer waits for the Lord. This is a posture of patience and expectancy, depending on the promises of God to us in His word. And I'll say this negatively. You will never experience real, lasting comfort if you look anywhere else. Everything else falls apart. Everything will eventually let you down in the long run, but not the Lord Himself. Our experience tells us this can't be. We say, wait, waiting is literally the thing that undermines my hope. I've had to wait too long, and that's why I'm losing hope, Pastor. The psalmist says, not if you look at the Lord. Why? Look at His character. He says, for with the Lord is steadfast love. He will never, ever do evil to those who trust in Him. And look as well, that with Him is plentiful redemption, that He Himself will buy everything back that was lost from Him. All debts will be paid by Him, and He and all that belongs to Him will be into His lap once more. And these promises, though dimly seen, perhaps even faded to black for a time in this life, are what the singer watches for and what he trusts in. And then lastly, the great why of this life of forgiveness. Friends, I want you to know forgiveness is more than a mere theological concept. It's meant to be a fuel for a heart explosion of lived out joy. Look at verse 4 where it tells us that forgiveness comes that God might be feared. Not that we would be afraid of Him. That's not what's meant. But that you would honor and reverence Him. That where He becomes a delight to you. And I just got to say, if you call yourself a Christian today, and you don't honor, and you don't love him. Maybe you've never tasted real forgiveness in the first place, or perhaps you've forgotten its taste. A heart that has been liberated by forgiveness delights in the one who has forgiven that debt. Listen to what Jesus himself says when he speaks to a woman captured by marvelous grace. He says, "I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much, but he who is forgiven little loves little." So what will cause us to love more? It's returning again and again to the promises. It's turning once more, again and again, to his very heart for us. Well, in closing, how in the world could this be? How in the world could this be true in such a way that God himself would forgive sins? Because I want to tell you that later in redemptive history, God himself would come and he would undergo the depths spoken of in verse 1. That God himself would undergo those deepest sufferings, death and even hell itself. You see, in Jesus, God would come and he too would cry out, but there would be no response and he would not stand. And though iniquity-free in himself, he would be marked by all our iniquities. Isaiah saw this, did he not, when he said, "He was crushed for what? For our iniquities. And the Lord laid on him," that is Jesus, "the iniquity of us all." And there, Jesus was buying us back, redeeming us to himself. I'd like to close with just a brief illustration, one that my preaching teacher, Dr. Brian Chappell, used to teach young aspiring pastors and preachers in seminary. And he tells a story that has stuck with me for nearly 15 years now. He tells the story that this happened in his hometown, where two brothers were playing on the sandbanks by the river. That one ran after another up this large mound of sand, and unfortunately the mound was not able to hold, it was not solid, and their weight caused them to sink in quickly. And that evening, when the boys did not return home for dinner, the family and neighbors organized a search. They found the younger brother there unconscious with his head and his shoulders sticking out above the sand, and they asked, when they cleared him, "Where is your brother?" And the child replied, "I'm standing on his shoulders." You see, with the sacrifice of his own life, the older brother went into the depths. And that's exactly what Jesus has done for us, that you and I might never have to. That his life, that his death holds us up in our life and in our death. And the tangible, sacrificial love of our older brother serves as the very foundation of our lives. And if our greatest problem, our sin, if it has been met with mercy, how will not everything else be clothed in mercy too? Amen and amen. Let's pray. It's almost too much, O Lord, to take in what you have done for us as sinners. Thank you that you love us. Thank you that you have promised to redeem us. Thank you that you have taken care of our greatest problem, that with you there is forgiveness, that you might be feared. Would you help us, O Lord, to live in light of that mercy? We pray that you would take these things, that you would put them deep into our hearts, and that we would now know that we have received welcome with you as we come to your table. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Would you stand and let's give thanks together. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is right and good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks unto you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Let's pray together the prayer our Lord taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. So as Ryan was talking about that this picture of the trash in the morning, it's Wednesday morning where I live, and when he comes home at 5 or 6, and I bet that he never opens it up and the trash is gone, and he just rejoices that there's no trash in there. Why? Well, because it's supposed to be gone. It's just kind of what we do. And I wonder sometimes if we're not that way with forgiveness. And I was just thinking as he was talking, if I had a heart rate monitor on when he was talking about how Jesus delights to forgive our sins and that we're cleansed, if my heart rate would have changed at all. And that's just the callousness of it that we all face, that the Lord Jesus, he was that older brother, and we're on his shoulders, and he delighted to forgive us so that we could have life. And he brings us back to this table week after week to experience the reality of that. You know, like probably the most famous hymn, Amazing Grace, one of the phrases John Newton says is, how precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Do y'all remember that? Do you remember? Man, I do. I remember the first time I realized I was forgiven for all the stuff I had ever done. And the Lord brings us back here to help us to never forget the wonder of the gospel. He delights to forgive us of our sins, adopt us into his family, and to love us with an everlasting love. So let's come to this table now and ask the Lord, Lord, we come to you now and we pray that by your Spirit, you would renew in us just a sense of wonder in the gospel. Lord, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast, unmeasured, boundless, free. Lord Jesus, we ask you that we would again be restored to the wonder of the gospel, that you would bless this time together at your table for Christ's sake. Amen. Scripture says that the Lord Jesus said, I received from the Lord, I also delivered unto you, that on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he gave thanks, he broke it. And he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, also after supper, he took the cup, and he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, and it's shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink all ye of it. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Brothers and sisters, Christ our Passover has been sacrificed for us. Hallelujah. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take these and remember that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith, and drink, remembering that Christ's blood has been shed for you. I would remind you, this is not a table of the Presbyterian Church in America. This is the Lord's table. It is for those who have true faith in Christ and are truly repentant. If that doesn't describe you, if maybe you heard what Ryan was talking about and you've never really experienced the new birth and you've never trusted Christ, don't receive these elements. They'll do you no good. Receive Christ. We'd love to talk to you about that. But it means that you're broken with your sin and you want to come and receive fresh a representation of the grace of the Lord, then this is for you. We come forward for communion. The ushers will come down the aisle and they will dismiss you by row, and you can come to one of the stations up here, and then you can commune together with your family. You can go back to your chair, your seat. There's no right way to do it. If you're unable to come forward, if you would let one of the ushers know, and we'll come and bring the elements to you. We have grape juice, which is the outer ring of the tray, and the inner ring is fermented wine, and the bread is all gluten-free. So I would invite the ushers to come forward, and we will receive the Lord's Supper together. Thank you.
Christ alone. My hope is found, for He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm.
Laid here in the death of Christ.
Once again, will you lift your heads, will you lift your hearts, and will you receive the Lord's benediction over you this morning? Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. Let us go out and serve the world in our city as those who love our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful Sunday.